Hello dear students, in my previous session we discussed globalization, the impacts of globalization and Earth University and Earth Democracy in What Nature Teaches, the previous part. We also discussed about the Earth Democracy. Earth Democracy means the freedom of all species, and we also discussed about Earth University, which is located at Navadhanya Farm in Doon Valley. So Earth University offers two major courses, like the A to Z of organic farming and agroecology and the Gandhi and globalization. So participants, those who come to Earth University, they study and they learn to work with living seeds, living soil and web of life. So living seeds, as I've already told you, organic and native quality seeds. Then living soil. Living soil is the fertile soil which is not nourished by the chemical manure. So we have discussed all these things in our previous class. Today in this session we are going to discuss the next and the last part of Vandana Shiva's article, Everything I Need to Know I Learned in the Forest, that is the poetry of the forest. So in this part, Vandana Shiva is going to discuss and describe Rabindranath Tagore's values and principles. So let us see what Vandana Shiva has written in this part. The Earth University is inspired by Rabindranath Tagore, India's national poet and a Nobel Prize laureate. So we all know Rabindranath Tagore. Rabindranath Tagore is our national poet who wrote our national anthem Jana Gana Mana. And Rabindranath Tagore is the only person from India who has got Nobel Prize for Literature in the year 1913 for his profoundly sensitive collection of poems in Gitanjali. So for his work Gitanjali in the year 1913, he has got Nobel Prize. So here Vandana Shiva says, the Earth University is inspired by Rabindranath Tagore, India's national poet and a Nobel Prize laureate. So Rabindranath Tagore's values and principles stimulated Vandana Shiva to establish this Earth University. She has established this because she inspired by Rabindranath Tagore. So next, Tagore started a learning center in Shantiniketan in West Bengal, India, as a forest school, both to take inspiration from nature and to create an Indian cultural renaissance. The school became a university in 1921, growing into one of India's most famous centers of learning. So here she has brought out one of the contributions of Rabindranath Tagore. So our national poet Rabindranath Tagore started a learning center, Shantiniketan, in West Bengal. He has started that Shantiniketan as a forest school. So the question is, why has he started? So Rabindranath Tagore started this Shantiniketan to take inspiration from nature. So Rabindranath Tagore, as a philosopher and an educationalist, he knows when nature accompanies a pupil, when nature accompanies a child, learning becomes easier, learning becomes very effective. So now we can remember our Gurukula system of education. So teaching was conducted under the shade of a tree. So nature used to accompany students, pupils. Rabindranath Tagore realized that when nature accompanies students, when nature accompanies a child, the learning becomes easier and effective. So that is the reason why he has started that Shantiniketan school as a forest school, a learning center, to take inspiration from the nature and to create an Indian cultural renaissance. So this Indian cultural renaissance, to revive that Indian culture, to restore the Indian culture, he has started this learning center Shantiniketan. Now we should remember our Gurukula system of education. So the school became a university in 1921, growing into one of India's most famous centers of learning. Today Shantiniketan Learning Center, which was established by Rabindranath Tagore, is now a university. In the year 1921, the Shantiniketan Learning Center has become a university. But again in the year 1951, that the same university has become the Central Research University. Now it is popularly known as Vishwa Bharati Central Research University, that is in West Bengal. So she continues, today Just as in Tagore's time, we need to turn to nature and the forest for lessons in freedom. So today our education system is modernized. We have Macaulay system of education. So the system which was introduced by the colonizers. And here Vandana Shiva states that we should go back to Rabindranath Tagore's time. We need to learn some lessons from the forest. It is very significant, very important to turn towards the nature. We have to be with the nature because, as she has already told in the previous parts of her essay, human, we are the inseparable part of nature. We cannot be separated from nature. So that we need to go with nature. We have to be with the nature. We have to learn some lessons for our good life. So in the next paragraph, Vandana Shiva has brought out a bit of Rabindranath Tagore's essay, Tapovan. So in his essay, Tapovan, which means forest of purity, Tagore writes, Indian civilization has been distinctive in locating its source of regeneration, material and intellectual in the forest, not the city. So Tapovan is Rabindranath Tagore's essay and she has taken a bit from his essay, Tapovan, which means the forest of purity. So Rabindranath Tagore's point of view, forest is a shrine. So forest of purity. So there in his essay Tapovan, Rabindranath Tagore writes, Indian civilization has been distinctive. Our Indian civilization, you know, is one of the unique civilization. It has been unique. It is, you know, different from other civilizations where in locating its source of regeneration, material and intellectual in the forest, not the city. So let us now understand what is civilization. Civilization is the stage of human social and cultural development and organizations that is considered to be advanced. So civilization describes the society, the culture and the way of life of a particular area. Civilization is nothing but the advanced life. So here Rabindranath Tagore says, Indian civilization has been distinctive, it has been unique in locating its source. So here Rabindranath Tagore writes, Indian civilization, our civilization has been unique. It is very different from others in locating its source of regeneration. Regeneration is nothing but the renewal of life. So where is it? It is in the forest, not in the city. And source of regeneration, material and intellectual. Material is nothing but it is an idea, that concept. Concept that we use in creating a work. So intellectual is something related to our cognition. And it is unique in locating its source of regeneration, material and intellectual. It is in the forest, not in the city. So the origin of Indian civilization is in the forest, not in the city. Next, he writes, India's best ideas have come where man was in communion with trees and rivers and lakes, away from the crowds. Where do you see the crowd? Yes, obviously it is in cities where you have the group of, you know, people. But here Rabindranath Tagore writes, India's best ideas have come. So you may ask, what are all the best ideas? See, you take our own scriptures, Indian scriptures like Mahabharata and Ramayana. You also have the Vedas and Upanishads. They were all written in the forest. Our sages, rishis, rishi munis were in the forest. And today we have one of the best practices in the world, that is yoga. And earlier that was practiced by our rishis. And today the world is practicing. And that idea has also come from the forest. So India's best ideas have come where man was in communion with nature. Communion, where man was in contact with the nature. So communion with trees, rivers, lakes, away from the crowds. You take our own, you know, Vedas and Upanishads. Take our scriptures. There, our rishis, you know, Valmiki and Vedavyas, they have written, they have mentioned the names of mountains, the names of lakes, the names of, you know, trees. So that means they were in contact with the nature. They were communion with the nature. They were not in the crowds. So next he writes, the peace of the forest has helped the intellectual evolution of man. So the peace of the forest, it is not just the stillness, it is not just the quietness, it is the tranquility. So it is the feeling that you get when you are in contact with the nature. So he says the peace, the tranquility of the nature, tranquility of the forest has helped the evolution, that has helped the intellectual evolution of man. So it has, the tranquility of the forest has helped the cognitive development of human beings, cognitive development of a man. So next, the culture of the forest has failed the culture of the Indian society. So the culture of the forest has failed, has given the power to the culture of the Indian society. So now we should understand, what is the culture of the forest? So culture of the forest, it is nothing but the cooperation. It is the harmony. It is the collaboration you have. So if you study the forest, if you go to the forest, if you see, you will definitely learn some good values in the forest. But how? So you see the life of the forest. You see the organisms that they live in the forest. Obviously, you can understand the cooperation, the collaboration. There is no violence, no war, no disputes, no contest. So every organism lives in harmony in the nature. There you have the cooperation. But whereas in the crowd, whereas in the cities, you don't have that. So the tranquility has helped the intellectual evolution of man, and the culture of the forest has helped the culture of the Indian society. Next, the culture that has arisen from the forest has been influenced by the diverse process of renewal of life, which are always at play in the forest, varying from species to species, from season to season, in sight and sound and smell. So now, Rabindranath Tagore says, the culture that has arisen from the forest, the culture which has influenced the Indian society, the culture which has fueled the culture of the Indian society, so that has been influenced by the diverse process of renewal of life in the forest. Renewal of life. So the nature always changes. So there you have the process of renewal of life which are always at play in the forest. Every time that would be changing, they are at play. And it changes, it varying from species to species, it changes in its species. So you might have heard, you might have read somewhere in the newspaper or in some magazines. So many birds, they migrate from different parts of the world to India to breed, and they come here for food. For many reasons they come, only in a particular season. So you might have observed, only in the winter season, some Australian birds, they come to, you know, a place which is located near Mysore, Ranganathittu, to breed. They come here for breeding purpose. They come here for food. They migrate from different parts of the world to different places. So the nature always changes in the species, and from season to season, in sight and sound and smell. The forest, the nature changes from species to species. It changes in its smell. It changes in its color. It changes in its sound. The sound that you hear in the rainy season is different from the summer season. The smell that you get in the spring season is different from the autumn season. Whereas in the autumn season, the color that you see is different from, again, the summer. So it changes, always, you know, it changes. And this process of renewal of life has influenced the culture of the forest. And that culture of the forest has given the power to the culture of the Indian society. So that is how it is different from all other civilizations. And we are influenced by that culture of the forest. And next he writes, the unifying principle of life in diversity of democratic pluralism thus became the principle of Indian civilization. So the unifying principle is nothing but being together. So joined together. So this principle of cooperation, this principle of collaboration, and the sacred relationship and the unperished relationship that you have with nature, along with that, this democratic pluralism, which means the coexist and more than one center of the power. And these things thus became the principle of Indian civilizations. So whatever the values and principles you have in our civilization, Indian civilizations, and these, the values, this culture have been influenced by the culture of the forest. Today in India, you can see different types of cultures, different types of practices, different types of customs. So though you have varieties of practices in your culture, though you have many cultures across the country, We say we are one, we are united. So here one of the values of Indian civilization is unity in diversity. You have the diverse life across the country, but you are one. We don't say he is different or we are different. So we are one. So this is the unifying principle of our Indian civilization. And now in the next paragraph, it is this unity in diversity that is the basis of both ecological sustainability and democracy. So here Vandana Shiva, she says, it is this unity in diversity. Unity in diversity is nothing but when you have the unity in diversity, you have the cooperation, you have the harmony. There is no violence. And this harmony is the basis of both ecological sustainability and the democracy. So this harmony is the basis of both ecological sustainability and democracy. So you have the sustainability on the earth, you have the sustainability in the ecology. So she continues, it is this unity in diversity that is the basis of both ecological sustainability and democracy. So here unity in diversity is nothing but the cooperation and harmony. So harmony with nature. So this harmony, this cooperation is the basis of both ecological sustainability and democracy. So, you know, if you have the cooperation, if you have the harmony, then you have the sustainability in the ecology. You also have the democracy. Democracy is nothing but the power of each and every organism. It is not the constitutional term that we have. It is the right of every organism. So to have the right, you know, there should be the cooperation, there should be harmony. Next, she says, diversity without unity becomes the source of conflict and contest. Unity without diversity becomes the ground for external control. This is true of both nature and culture. The forest is a unity in its diversity, and we are united with nature through our relationship with the forest. So she says, diversity without unity becomes the source of conflict and contest. So let's say you have, you know, varieties of species. Let us assume all of us are different. We are not same, both mentally and physically. We are not same. So there are several types of human beings. But if there is no unity in them, if there is no unity among the species, if there is no unity among the people, then that will definitely leads to disputes, contest. There will be violence, fights. And next, unity without diversity. Let us say you are united, you are one, but there is no diversity. All of us are same, both mentally and physically. All are, you know, as equal as others. So when you have this unity without diversity, then what will happen? If all are equal, then everybody starts controlling over others. And next she says, this is true of both nature and culture. There should be unity in the diversity. In both, whether it is culture or the nature, there should be unity in diversity, that she says. And next, the forest is a unity in its diversity, and we are united with nature through our relationship with the forest. So as I have already told you, we have an unperished bondage with unperished relationship with the nature, with the forest. Through our unperished relationship with the forest, we are united with nature. We are not separated from the nature. We are one. So next, Vandana Shiva continues, in Tagore's writings, the forest was not just the source of knowledge and freedom. It was the source of beauty and joy, of art and aesthetics, of harmony and perfection. It symbolized the universe. The forest teaches us union and compassion. So here Vandana Shiva says, in Tagore's writing, the forest was not just the source of knowledge. It was not just the source of, you know, freedom. As he has already told, the peace of the forest has helped the intellectual evolution of man. The culture of the forest has influenced the culture of the Indian society. So she says, in Tagore's writing, the forest is not just the source of knowledge and freedom. As Tagore says, forest, the peace of the forest has helped the intellectual evolution of man. It has helped the cognitive development of man. It is not just the source of knowledge and freedom. It does not only show the freedom, the you know, the mutual understanding or the cooperation among organisms in the forest. It is not just the source of freedom and knowledge, but it was the source of beauty and joy, of art and aesthetics. So Rabindranath Tagore is also a nature poet, and it was also the source of beauty. So it was also the source of majestic scene in the forest. It is also the source of breathtaking beauty in the forest, the serenity you have in the nature. So it was not just the source of knowledge and freedom, it was also the source of beauty that you can see, the beauty that you can observe in the nature. So as we all know, Rabindranath Tagore is also one of the nature poet. He loves the nature and he loves the verdant weave of the forest. So he says, he pointed out in his works that the nature, the forest, also symbolizes the universe. It was the source of joy, it was the source of happiness, source of, you know, knowledge and freedom, art and aesthetics. With all these things, the forest also symbolized the universe. So when we say universe, you have everything. So even in nature, even in the forest, you have the values, you have the principles. Whatever you can learn in the world, the same things can be learned in the forest. So that is what he states in his works. And the forest teaches us union and compassion. So she says, the source of knowledge, source of freedom, source of everything, source of happiness. So forest also teaches us the union and compassion. What is union? The unity we have, the unity that forest has. The forest teaches us the unity, which means it teaches us the, you know, all major values of a good life. Next, it teaches us the compassion. Compassion is nothing but the kindness and the mercy. Mercy with each other. So you can learn this cooperation, you can learn this non-violence, mutual understanding, mutual giving, cooperation, collaboration. All these things can be learned in the forest. And next, the forest also teaches us the enoughness. As she has already told, the forest is a teacher of abundance, the diversity, and the forest, the nature, is a teacher of abundance. She has learned many things from the forest. And here, it not only teaches to our author, but also teaches to everyone, it teaches us the enoughness, whatever is essential for our, you know, good life. So everything would be taught by the forest. Now, as a principle of equity, how to enjoy the gift of nature without exploitation and accumulation. So here, Vandana Shiva has told, the forest teaches us the enoughness, like the principle of equity. Principle of equity is nothing but everyone is equal. So being fair, being impartial, there is no differentiation, there is no bias. So when you go through the forest, you will learn all these things as a principle of equity, as a principle of being impartial, how to enjoy the gift of nature without exploitation and accumulation. So, forest teaches this lesson exclusively for the human beings. So, what is that lesson? As a principle of equity, how to enjoy the gift of nature without exploitation and accumulation. No other creatures on this earth is exploiting the nature, is exploiting the forest, but the human beings. So this lesson is taught to the human beings how to enjoy the gifts of nature. So whatever you have today in your life, you know, whatever the things that you use right from morning till you go to bed, everything has been given by the nature. That is the gift of nature. So today, what are we doing? We are just subjugating and exploiting the nature. So we should understand that the gifts have been given by the nature and it has to be used without exploiting it. So like forest is one of the gifts of nature and rivers are also gifts of nature. Today, what are we doing? We are simply polluting the river water. We are cutting down the trees. We are exploiting the nature. We are dominating over the nature. So we are deforming the earth, you know, in order to support the industrial revolution, in order to support the industries. So here, forest teaches us something. We have to learn how to enjoy these gifts which have been given by the nature. Then Tagore quotes from the ancient texts written in the forest. Know all that moves in this moving world as enveloped by God and find enjoyment through renunciation, not through greed and possession. So Rabindranath Tagore, in his essay Tapovan, he has quoted a line from the ancient text which says, "Know all that moves in this moving world as enveloped by the God, and find the enjoyment through renunciation, not through greed and possession." So now we should understand it is a triangular relationship between the God and the nature and the human being. So there is a triangular relationship between these three things. So God has given us a gift, that is nature, and there is a relationship, there is an unbreakable bondage between these two, nature and human beings. So as she says, the gifts of nature have to be used without exploiting them. So that line explains, that line describes the triangular relationship between the God, nature and humans. So as Vandana Shiva says, you know, we have to make use of the gifts of nature without exploiting them. Here, as that line says, everything moves in this moving world as enveloped by the God. Enveloped is nothing but the design. So God has already designed something. So he has a plan. According to his plan, the world is running today. So now here, everything, know all that moves in this moving world. We have to understand everything that moves in this moving world as enveloped by the God, according to the plan of the God. As per his plan, the world moves, and we have to find the enjoyment through renunciation, not through greed of possession. So greed of possession is nothing but the excessive desire to acquire the wealth or the power. We have to understand the gift of God, gift of nature. We should not exploit them, and everything that moves in this moving world according to the plan of the God, as per his plan that moves, we have to enjoy these things through renunciation, through donating, not through the greed of possession. Greed of possession is the excessive desire to acquire the power, acquire the wealth. Next, she says, no species in a forest appropriates the share of another species. Every species sustains itself in cooperation with others. So here Vandana Shiva says, no species in the forest, no organism in the nature in the forest appropriates is nothing but take away. So no species, no organism in the forest take away the share of another species. Okay, they just take what is needed for them, how much required for their life. So the animals or the birds or any organisms in the forest, they don't have this greed. So only to lead their life, only for their livelihood, you know, they take their shares. So now every species sustains itself in cooperation with others. So animals or birds or any organisms in the forest, they don't have this greedy nature. They don't have greed of possession. They live in cooperation. They live in harmony with other organisms. They live in harmony with the nature. So she says, the end of consumerism and accumulation is the beginning of joy of living. So as per her words, when we get rid of this accumulating nature, when we get rid of this consumerism, that is the beginning of joy of our living. So when are we going to start our happy life? So when we get away from that accumulating nature, when we give up that excessive desire to acquire the wealth or power or anything for that matter. So in the last paragraph, Vandana Shiva says, the conflict between greed and compassion, conquest and cooperation, violence and harmony that Tagore wrote about continues today. So she says, the conflict, the clash between greed and compassion, the greedy nature and the kindness, there is a fight, there is a clash between this, you know, greed of possession and compassion, kindness, and the conflict between conquest and cooperation. Conquest is nothing but the war that we are doing, the disputes that we have in our lives, and the contest that we do on everyday basis over nature. And conquest and cooperation, where do you see the cooperation? In the nature. But the conquest is in our lives. And violence and harmony, violence, that brutality, that cruelty, violence and harmony, where do you see the violence, the brutality in human beings? But the cooperation and the harmony in the nature. So these conflicts, whatever she has mentioned here, they still continue today. They are still there with us. They are still there in the world. So, and it is the forest that can show us the way beyond this conflict. So every day you could see this brutality, cruelty, you know, like violence, fight, disputes, contest in our lives. But whereas in the forest, you have the kindness, you have the compassion, you have the freedom, you have the right. So these things are still continuing. So even today, they are still with us. This clash, this, you know, contest, we see on daily basis. And she says, it is the forest. It is the forest that can show us the way beyond this conflict. To get away from this conflict, you have to go through with the nature. You have to be with the nature. So you have to learn something from the nature. So when you are with the nature, you can definitely get away. You can definitely get rid of all these clashes, all these conflicts. So eventually, with this article, Vandana Shiva says, we have to build a future in which humans live in harmony with nature. We have to restore the greatest symphony on earth. We should have the cooperation. We should have this mutual understanding. So as a part of earth community, as a part of earth family, we have to respect each and every organism. We have to identify their rights, and we should have the cooperation and the harmony with all other organisms on earth. With that, we should also protect the biodiversity. We should conserve the nature. We should conserve the forest, because without nature, without forest, no organism on this earth can be survived. So let us do a resolution. Let all of us plant a tree for the betterment of our future. Thank you.